Gabbele ponos je pone, aschendien kai saulus calviso angleschke je nelie tumischke. Ere der pai papraschau so rast vertea mokitioi curigali versi mokitschu calva jango calva nelie tumu calva. Delto da ban calviso angleschke. My task today is a rather not simple one, but the impressive paper Cyrus gave on could only shortly touch on the question how the Holocaust decision, the decision to murder all Jews in German hands, was taken. So I will focus on this one, on this question, using historiography by Israeli, by German, by English and American historians. And I would emphasize that the timeline of this decision is very important, and hopefully I can give a broader framework for the articles to come. So, when and how the final decision was taken to murder all Jews in the regions under German control? This question may at first appear superfluous. After all, Adolf Hitler and his party never made any secret of their hatred of the Jews. Going back to the early political career of the failed Austrian painter, countless records can be found to document this hatred, which was to find its expression in anti-Semitic laws after Hitler seized power in 1933 and in violence against the German Jews at the latest from 1938 onwards. Was the plan to murder the Jews in place from the beginning and only carried out rigorously later on? The issue is not so simple. Today's historical research views the road to the Holocaust as a complex and by no means direct curse. It involved a decision process which was influenced by large numbers of actors, players, and which went through many different stages and phases of radicalization before it culminated in the universal murder of European Jews at the last possible act, the so-called final solution. Terminology is a particular problem for historians researching this period. When Hitler spoke of a final solution to the Jewish question at the beginning of the 1930s, he did not mean the same as Heinrich Himmler in 1943 in his infamous Posen speech. From the start, the National Socialists used the language of disguise, making it imperative for historians to consider the respective time horizon and setting. To give a further example, in 1939, the expression deportation to the East really did mean the transportation of German Jews to as yet unestablished ghettos in occupied Poland. In 1942, as we all know, the same expression was no more than a deceptive term for the indiscriminate murder of all German and European Jews transported to the East. The historical researches then represent a somewhat difficult and critical foundation on which to base the research for answers to the question. Where are the turning points to be found? Where is there evidence of surges of radicalization? And where do we still have evidence of orders issued? In this account, I will, for good reasons, focusing on the year 1941, because everything indicates that the final decision, in German this is Entschlussfindung, the awkward but appropriate term used for the prelude to the Holocaust, is to be found in this year. However, before we look at 1941 in more detail, I will give a brief review of the events followed September 1, 1939. The outbreak of war led to the first escalation of violence against supposed opponents of National Socialism in occupied Poland. Together with the Polish intelligentsia, it was Jews who, from the very beginning, were the principal victims of SS Special Operation Units and Wehrmacht camps. It is, however, an indisputable fact that in the autumn of 1939, there was no order to commit full-scale murder. In 1940 and the early months of 1941, the situation intensified in occupied Poland and in the territories which had belonged to the Republic of Poland from 1919 to 1939 and were now annexed against the German Reich. These self-imposed problems can be traced back to, if one will, the so-called positive side of National Socialist racial politics. At the beginning of the war, Heinrich Himmler was named Reichskommissioner for the Strengthening of German Nationhood. He was responsible not only for actions against the enemies of the Nordic Aryan race, but also for making ethnic Germans returning home to the Reich, into a racial bulwark as colonists in the occupied and reclaimed territories. The settlement of these people, bringing back thousands of people, the settlement of these people necessarily involved the expulsion and deportation of others. That is, it was mainly Poles and Jews who became the victims of this policy. The NS and SS authorities soon found that they were not up to this task, and they were increasingly unable to cope with the chaos they had created. The suggestions as to what should be done with the useless Poles and Jews consequently became more and more radical. It was thus no coincidence that it was the SS-Sturmbannführer Höppner, responsible for the relocation center in Posen, who wrote to Adolf Eichmann on July 16, 1941, quote, "There is a danger that it will no longer be possible to feed all the Jews this winter. It should be seriously considered whether it would not be the most human solution. It's terrible. It would not be the most human solution to dispose of those Jews who are unable to work by some fast-acting means. This would certainly be more pleasant than to have them die of starvation." Some time ago, Kurz Ali pointed out this connection between the relocation policy and the Holocaust, and convincingly argued that for the relocation bureaucrats, liquidation was in the end the only option left if they were to put their plans into action. When further deportations were suspended in the spring of 1941, the ethnicity question escalated anew. These bans had to do with the next decisive move towards radicalization, Germany's invasion of the Soviet Union. From the start, Hitler and the NS leadership had planned this war as one of conquest and destruction. The so-called criminal orders given in the run-up to the German invasion have been known for a long time. It's the Commissar Order, which denied the political commissars of the Red Army combatant status and ordered the execution. The Barbarossa Jurisdiction Order, which removed crimes committed by German soldiers against civilians. And ever to be mentioned, the murder or dying of millions of captured Red Army soldiers in German prisoner of war camps. Added to all this were the special security police commandos, which were to carry out mass shootings behind the front line. Saul's talked already about these units, the so-called special operation units of the German security police and security service. Was the decision in favor of the Holocaust taken in the curse of the preparations for Operation Barbarossa? In his major work on Heinrich Himmler, the architect of the final solution, Richard Weidmann, argues that this is the case, given the qualitative launch of large-scale mass murders in the spring of 1941, and the fact that these were initiated by the top leaders in the Adolf Hitler himself. There are, however, several pieces of evidence to contend this thesis. The most important issue is the nature of the murders committed by the special operation units. It is true that all four units, as well as the task and special commandos subordinate to them, carried out large-scale executions from the first day onward. However, Saulus talked about this. Until the middle of August, their victims were almost exclusively male Jews between 16 and 50 years. And it was not some time between August and October. October 1941, that all commandos, we had 84 commandos in that region of Operation Barbarossa. All four commandos first crossed the ultimate line and began also to murder the women and children in the end. It is thus clear that there cannot have been a general command in June 1941 to murder all Jews in the Soviet Union, and that an order possibly issued at the later date was not conveyed centrally or to all commandos at the same time. Regional dynamics, practical experience of mass crimes, and murderous competition among the various commandos clearly played their role in the process, as did numerous personal appeals made by Himmler and Heydrich during frontline visits, in which they urged the perpetrators to be even more harsh and radical in their actions. By the early autumn of 1941 at the latest, it was clear that the lives of all Soviet Jews in the German-occupied area of the Soviet Union were in danger. Beyond a doubt, the threshold to genocide had thus been crossed. Saulus made this also very clear. Also, there was still a territorial restriction. In Western Europe, as in the German Reich and in occupied Poland, the Jewish population was still alive. In the autumn of 1941, the Holocaust was limited to the Jews within the state boundaries of the Soviet Union as they were on June 22, 1941. So, the Holocaust, the final solution, related not only to the Soviet Jews, but to all Jewish community under German control. In this context, we must look at a further key document dated July 31, 1941. Hermann Göring's naming of SS single group leader and chief of the Reichsmain Security Office, Reinhard Heydrich, as responsible for the implementation of the final solution to the Jewish question. We now know far more details than we did just a few decades ago. Responsibility for the implementation of the final solution to the Jewish question was passed to Heydrich already back in January 1941. Also, he was not to carry this out until after the war. The plans clearly foresaw a huge Jewish reservation in Eastern Europe, as briefly planned after the defeat of France in Madagascar. Göring's instruction to Heydrich has to be definitely seen in this context. These plans already implied that there would be mass mortality among the victims of the Europe-wide resettlement. This authorization is directly connected to the Wannsee Conference of January 1942. So, in the fact that the SS was authorized to carry out the final solution still does not provide a convincing answer to our question. However, another incident proves once more that none of this could have happened without Adolf Hitler's knowledge, initiative and support. In August and September 1941, the Führer made decisions which were to have far-reaching consequences. Very much to the surprise of those around him, he gave in to the requests he had long been receiving from various Gauleiter to be allowed to deport their Jews to the East. Until this point, Hitler had shown consideration for opinion on the home front and had refused to allow what would be overtly public deportation. Now, however, the Jews were to be taken to the East. His second decision, that they also had to be at the Star of David in public, finally forced the German Jews into the same status as the Jews living in the East, a status, as we all know, without any rights. The motives and reasons behind these decisions of Hitler's are critical for an understanding of our question. By the late summer, early autumn of 1941, any last hopes of a rapid victory over the Soviet Union had dissipated. Saulus talked about this, or if the decision was taken out of euphoria, or because the German leadership foresaw a long war against the Soviet Union. So, the war against the Soviet Union would not end as a blitzkrieg. There is something to be said for the idea that the difficult war situation played a role in the decision of December 1941. In describing the connection between the curse of the war and the murders, Tobias Jersak picked up this train of thought, but also took the arguments further. In his argumentation, he refers to the famous prophecy Hitler made in his Reichstag speech on January 13, 1931, the anniversary of his becoming Reichschancellor. Quote, "In the course of my life, I have very often been a prophet and have usually been ridiculed for it. During the time of my struggle for power, it was in the first instance the Jewish race which only received my prophecies with laughter when I said that I would one day take over the leadership of the state and with it that of the whole nation, and that I would then, among many other things, settle the Jewish question. The laughter was uproarious, but I think that for some time now they have been laughing on the other side of the face. Today I will once more be a prophet. If the international Jewish financiers in and outside Europe should succeed in plunging the nation once more into a world war, then the result will not be the Bolshevization of the earth and thus the victory of Jewry, but the annihilation of the Jewish race in Europe." Jersak's line of argument is as simple as it is captivating. He analyzes which events could have been proof for Hitler that the Jews had in fact succeeded in provoking a world war. He concludes that Hitler felt the declaration of the Atlantic Charter to have been the final move. This charter resulted from a meeting between the English Prime Minister Winston Churchill and the President of the United States, Franklin Roosevelt, at that point still a neutral power. And indeed, the document signed by the two statesmen on August 14, 1941 in Placentia Bay openly and unmistakably assumes that Germany will be defeated. It was thus foreseeable that the German Reich would not succeed in obtaining hegemony in Europe and that sooner or later the United States would enter the war on the side of the enemy. It is also of particular note that Hitler made several fundamental strategic and political decisions immediately after he was informed about the proclamation of the Atlantic Charter. Shortly afterwards, on August 17th and 18th, he had intensive discussions with Heinrich Himmler, who was chiefly responsible within the NS leadership for the Holocaust. And just one day later, on August 20th, as indicated above, he fulfilled Joseph Goebbels' greatest wish, something he had always refused to do up to that point, to allow the deportation of German Jews to the East and to order that the German Jews also get to be at the Star of David. And finally, we should consider the fact mentioned earlier that the special operation units had begun in August 1941 to extend their circle of victims to genocidal dimensions. On September 17, 1941, Goebbels' report to Hitler's consent proved to be true, for it was on this date that he ordered the first deportation of German Jews to the East. Clearly, this decisive weeks in the month of August and September 1941 represent a further dramatization. November of the same year is another clear turning point, with the annihilation position increasingly gaining the upper hand within the German leading circles. Goebbels published his infamous article, "The Jews Are to Blame." It was at this time that the first gas masks were used in Chelmo and the first Jews from the Reich shot in the Baltic region. The policy towards the Reich Jews in particular speaks for itself. The regime was clearly ridding itself of its very last scruples. Does this answer our initial question? was the decision taken in the summer of 1941 to approve murder of all Jews a reaction to the Atlantic Charter? Did it reflect the increasing influence of the USA and the resulting inevitability of the European war becoming a world war? Let us take a look at the terminus antiquem. It is generally known that the plans for the implementation of the Holocaust were set in motion at the so-called Wannsee Conference held on January 20, 1942. The conference was attended by Reinhard Heydrich and high-ranking representatives of the ministries and authorities which would be involved in the planned deportation, and was the final step in expanding the murder program to include Western European Jews and so to pursue the final solution to the Jewish question. There is no doubt that the decision to murder all Jews must have taken before the Wannsee Conference. In the mid-1990s, Christian Gerlach proposed an interesting thesis based on the fact that the conference was originally planned for December 9, 1941. He believes that it was not until early December 1941 that Hitler made the fundamental decision to murder all Jews as a reaction to political initiatives and experiences of murder of Jews in the East. Indeed, as late as November 1941, an order was evidently issued not to murder the German Jews deported to Riga, where Friedrich Jerkent, senior SS and police leader Ostland, already had started to liquidate German Jews. No. There were the systematic murders of the Jewish population in Poland in 1941. Gerlach argues that the original topic of the conference was the treatment of the German Jews, the original topic of the Wannsee Conference, but that this has changed by January 20th. So why? Indeed, there are a number of sources from December 1941 which indicate an increasingly brutal attitude among the NS leadership with respect to the Jewish question. Of particular note is the meeting of the NSDAP regional and national leaders, Reichsgauleiter, with Hitler on the afternoon on December 12, 1941. That is just a day after Hitler declared war on the United States. Goebbels noted, quote, "With respect to the Jewish question, the Führer is determined to wipe the stake. The safety. He prophesies to the Jews that if they were ever again to bring about a world war, it would be their destruction. The world war has arrived. The annihilation of the Jews must necessarily follow." Quote end. Not only had Hitler now spoken of total annihilation, but he had done so in front of a circle of leading NS officials, including those responsible for the annihilation policy up to that point. However, this does not, of course, mean that Hitler had not already announced his intent or agreed to further radicalization at earlier meetings with the SS leadership. Let us come to a close. Everything speaks in favor of the argument that the decision, that is, the general order to murder all European Jews, was given in the second half of 1941. This decision was preceded by a drawn-out process of radicalization and decision-making which culminated between August and December of 1941 in the final solution. This is clearly shown, firstly by the fact that from the middle of August 1941, the mass murders by the special operation units in the occupied regions of the Soviet Union were extended to include Jewish women and children. Secondly, by the decision in September to deport German Jews to the East and the actual start of these deportations in September and October 1941. And thirdly, by the first indications as of autumn 1941 that special annihilation camps were being constructed in Poland, or the function of the existing Konzentrationslager like Auschwitz were changed. All these developments accumulated no later than mid-December 1941 in Hitler making probably a number of short statements of his intention to exterminate European Jewry. A written order, as generations of historians have sought to find, a written order was not required if you're a state. So it is futile to look forward. And of course, there's absolutely no doubt that Adolf Hitler was not only informed and approved of the Holocaust from the start, but also that he was the initiator, or one of the initiators of this, the crime of the century. Thus, on March 21st, 1942, Goebbels was completely right to note in his diary, quote, "A punishment is being meted on the Jews, which is admittedly a barbaric one, but one which is entirely their due. The prophecy the Führer made them should they instigate a new world war is now beginning to come true in a most terrible way. One must not be sentimental about such matters. The Jews would destroy us if we did not resist them. It is a life and death struggle between the Aryan race and the Jewish species. No other government and no other regime would be able to raise the strength to carry out a general solution to these problems. Here too, the Führer is a steadfast champion and spokesman of a radical solution."